God is good, huh? Breakthrough just ahead. We all need a breakthrough at some stage in our lives. I remember many years ago when my youngest son, about age about five, had a very serious head accident, and I'm stood by the side of his bed. He's just having brain surgery, and I said, "Oh God, I need a breakthrough." I remember at times when financially me and Rachel looked at the pantry and thought, what are we going to feed our kids? And then we laid out the bills on the table and said, how are we going to pay these? And I said, oh God, we need a breakthrough. I remember being by the side of my own wife, who was very seriously ill with malaria 20 years ago, and doctors called me in the middle of the night saying, we're losing her, we need to be doing something. And I said, oh God, I need a breakthrough. I remember being with the church, and it's like year after year after year, not being able to find a building, and the church not growing, and we were doing everything we knew how to do. We were working as hard then as we do now, and just nothing coming. And I remember going through many seasons of prayer. I remember having weeks of prayer and fasting, and for me and Rachel taking months and months of taking at least a day a week fasting before God and saying, oh God, we need a breakthrough, and me wanting to give up many times and saying, they've had their breakthrough, they've had their breakthrough, they've had their breakthrough, but what about me? And then, you know, it's easy to get into a pity party, isn't it? And say, what about me? What big sin did I commit? What is it about my poor faith? What is it about me? And you get into a place eventually where if you're not careful, you feel like, you've heard me say this before, it's one step forward, two steps back, or every time you want to take a step forward, brick wall. Do you recognize any of that? Lord, why can't I get that job that I need and everybody else seems to? You need a breakthrough. Oh Lord, this health, this problem, you need a breakthrough. What about the relationship with your husband and your wife, and you're feeling like, oh, I married the wrong person. No, you didn't marry the wrong person. You just, both of you need a breakthrough. You know, there's all sorts of, your children are off the rails. Maybe they started drinking. Maybe they've gone into drugs. Maybe they made a real big mistake and they came home and told you that she's pregnant or something. I mean, big stuff, isn't it? Well, how do you cope with that? How do you move forward? We all of us, at times in our life and regularly in our life, actually need a breakthrough. Well, I've got some good news for you today. God is the God of breakthrough. You've all heard the quote that if it's too good to be true, then it's too good. Haven't you? You know, you get the letter through the post that says, you could be a millionaire. And you know, and all the wise financial people have said, no, it's too good to be true. You know, that insurance policy, it's too good to be true. That finance thing, it's too good to be true. You know, and it is wisdom to be able to look at some of these get-rich-quick things or whatever else and say it is too good to be true. But you know, when it comes to the miracle working power of Jesus Christ in your life, it's not too good to be true. It is just too good, and it is true, because God is a miracle working God. We're living in a day where thinking says the miraculous, no, don't go there, that's crazy. Well, of course, there are some crazy things talked about that. There are some crazy things claimed about that. But the Bible is full of the miracle working power, the grace of God that is in action in our lives that can do for us what nothing else can do. Let's have a look. Let's have an explore this morning from the Bible, from the Word of God, about breakthrough and how we can say to you, if you're facing something right now, lift up your eyes and look. There's a salvation moment coming for you. There's a deliverance moment coming for you. And we can do that without any risk or fear of being just overly optimistic, because actually we're not talking about optimism here. We're talking about faith. I want to stir and increase and plant a seed of faith in your heart and thinking and in mind too, that we can face life with the idea of not trouble ahead, there's trouble ahead, but to have a new song in our heart and say there's breakthrough ahead in the name of Jesus. Amen? We're going to read a fairly lengthy passage of scripture you might want to turn with me to it? Psalm 91. Think about it in the context of breakthrough for you. Psalm 91 says this: He, that's you or me, who dwells in the shelter of the Most High, that's God Himself, will rest. The word rest is good. That's a real come to a place of peace moment. Will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. In other words, God is watching over everything, and when you're in His shadow, you're okay. Verse 2, I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge, my fortress, my God in whom I trust. What a great confession. That's a positive faith confession which you need to say every day. Verse 3, surely, in other words, with absolute confidence, He will save you from the fowler's snare. That just is from hidden traps, you know, like people put traps in the woods to be able to catch an animal or something. Well, you know, the devil sets traps for you. People can set traps for you, but you don't need to have a worry about the fowler's snare or from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you over with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. That's just a picture of God stretching out a place of comfort and strength over you. And His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor will you fear the arrow that flies by the day, nor will you fear the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. Well, we all get afraid of those things, don't we? But the Bible's saying when you understand there's breakthrough ahead, you don't have a fear of that. In verse 7, okay, this is circumstances now. 1,000 may fall at your right side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. We've all got a quote to say, yeah, but it happened to my friend. Listen, you are not your friend. You are somebody who is a son or a daughter of the living God, and God's promises are over you. Who knows what they did by claiming their place of faith? Maybe it would work like that for you if you don't, but if you claim a place of faith and the favor of God on you, God will watch over you, and He'll watch over His word concerning you. Verse 8 says, you will observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked, but if you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord who is your refuge, then no harm will befall you, no disaster will come near your tent. Anybody here living in a tent? Okay, translate it into 2017, into your home, into your environment, into your life as you're living it right now. Verse 11, for He will command His angels concerning you. That's their job, to guard you. In all your ways, they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against the stone. Some of this is very prophetic of Jesus, but the basis of this psalm is not just limited to Jesus. Prophetically, it's directed at me and you today, and we can claim the word of God. Verse 13, you'll tread upon the lion and the cobra. We don't recommend it. It's just talking about dangerous and awful moments when you'll find yourself in your journey in a terrible moment. But you will trample the great lion and the serpent. And verse 14, because He loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him and I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. We were acknowledging the name of Jesus this morning, weren't we? Lifting high the name of Jesus. And when you and me do that, He will rescue us. He will protect us. Verse 15, He will call upon me and I will answer Him. That's a great promise from God. This is God saying to you, I will be with you in trouble. I will deliver you and I will honor you. And with long life will I satisfy you and show you my salvation. I'm changing that a bit to make it very personal. What an incredible psalm it is. You know, in the Bible, there were many examples of people and situations who hit the brick wall. Do you remember the children of Israel when they were on their way out of deliverance? It was like they were in a brick wall in Egypt. Do you remember? And they were slaves. And Moses went to Pharaoh and said, let my people go. And he hit a brick wall. You know, the first thing, I was going to show you four things this morning about breakthrough, and the first one is about hitting a brick wall. You are going to hit a brick wall. If you never hit a brick wall, you don't need a breakthrough. If you never face a challenge, you don't need a miracle. If you never get sick, you don't need healing. It is all about facing the brick wall. The children of Israel hit the brick wall. Moses, bang, 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 bang. But God made a way through the brick wall eventually. They got on their journey and they must have thought, right, that's the end of all the challenges. Now it's going to be miracle, miracle, miracle all the way through to the promised land until they met the River Jordan. It's another brick wall. They had to take some steps of faith. They had to go and do some things. We'll talk about the steps that we're going to do in a minute. But it was another brick wall. But God made a way through the brick wall. He did it not only through the Red Sea, but later on he did it through the River Jordan. When it looked impossible, when it looked in their natural eyes, we're out here and it's never going to happen, God made a way. And then eventually, when they were right on their tiptoe of going into the promised land, they faced a city called Jericho. It was their next, and it literally was, a brick wall. What were they going to do? Well, thank God for Pastor Joshua, who had a vision, who had an understanding, who heard God, and God gave him a plan, and the plan was to go and walk around. I mean, the plan wasn't going to do it by might nor by power. The plan was to go and do it by my spirit, says the Lord, because God had a plan. There are some things that you can change with your intellect. There are things that you can do with your wisdom. There are things that you can do with planning, and you should. But there are some things that with all of the power and all of the abilities that you've got, and of all the ability of your friends that you've got, or your doctor that you've got, or your MP that you've got, or whatever else, there are some things that only God can do. There's only God that could bring the walls of Jericho down. They hit a brick wall. They didn't have any money. We've read the story from the end. But you've got to remember that on the seventh day, when they'd gone round that four or five times on that last day, they must have been saying, what in the world is all this about? Just like you've done in some of the circumstances that you're in. May you've been facing some issues emotionally. Maybe you've been facing some things with your mental health. Maybe you've been facing some things with you just feeling completely trapped because of circumstances in your past. Maybe the stuff that's gone on in your past that hurt you, that locked you up, and you thought, how am I ever going to break out of this? It's like hitting a brick wall. I want you to remember something, that every time you face a brick wall, God's got a plan of escape. Just like he was able to bring down the walls of Jericho, God is able to make a way for you. Hallelujah. There's another time in the children of Israel's life. We're just going to do a couple of illustrations just so you get the idea. Oh, you can read about this in the Bible. And it's like you've got the Israelites camped on one side of the hill. And there's a valley in the middle. And on the other side, you've got the Philistines. And the leader of the Philistines is a great big chap called Goliath. He's big, he's huge, and he's got an inbuilt PA system. And he used to bellow out over the valley about the children of Israel and call them all sorts of names. And he would say, listen, you crazy, silly people, you can't do this and all the rest of it. And they, children of Israel, hit a brick wall. The king, Saul, sat in his tent, worrying, not sleeping at night, got with all of his advisors around him, looking at his shields, looking at his sword and all the rest, didn't dare to go and fight the Philistine. By the way, there are many brick walls that are out there that are psychological. What Goliath was doing was playing games with the minds of the children of Israel. He was just one man. Okay, he had a couple of brothers as well that were big, and the armies there, but these were the armies of the Lord. If they only had been thinking right, they wouldn't have been so afraid. Many times, the enemy will psychologically want to get you and magnify inside your mind the problems that you're facing. That's why the Bible tells you to magnify the Lord. Don't magnify the problem, magnify the Lord. I will magnify the Lord. We need to magnify means to make big. Magnify the Lord. The enemy wants to magnify the problem. You know, you had a little bit of a funny conversation with the boss at work, and you come home, and you've already got him sacking you and demoting you and all that. Don't magnify the problem. Magnify the Lord of the problem. You just felt that you hit a brick wall, but I want you to remember every time you hit the brick wall that there is a God who can make those walls fall for you. We'll show you how some of that will happen in just a moment. It was a crisis moment. Enter David. David who saw beyond the brick wall. David who saw beyond Goliath. David who said, oh, listen, I've fought a lion, I've fought a bear, listen, I'm only a young lad, but you give me the opportunity. I love the David spirit, don't you? You know, we need to have a David spirit if we're going to see breakthrough. We're not going to have a sit-down spirit. We need a David spirit. God, I pray that you'll put in every one of us in this congregation today and all those people that are watching us around in many countries in the world, let there be a David spirit, a young man's spirit that will rise on the inside of us and not look at the brick wall and say, I can't, but look at the brick wall and say, in the name of Jesus, we're going to win through. Who is this Philistine, this ungodly man? And he picked up 5 stones and he slung it, and it was the first guided missile of all time. And I tell you, it wasn't just so much that David had a good aim, although I think he did. I think if he'd have aimed it out there and Goliath was out there, God would have put a swerve on that stone and it would have come right by, landed there, and he was dead. And you've heard the story, haven't you? He was 1 stone heavier dead than he was alive. Yeah, okay, the ripple of the joke slowly goes over there. Dead. You've hit a brick wall. We've all hit a brick wall times. A brick wall for us as a church many years ago about growth. We couldn't break through. You had to come to a place where you start to believe that God is a God of miracles and that what naturally you can't do. I mean, how did, for instance, our breakthrough numerically as a church, for instance, just in that, we could talk about financially as well in different ways. How did that happen? Well, it was because we sat down and we had this organizing committee, you know, and we were dead smart and we worked it all out. It's not true. What we did is we sat down and we prayed. And we gave to God the desire of our hearts. I said, God, we've hit a brick wall. How is this going to happen? And when we look back now over the 10 years that we've been in this building, when we just moved in here with just literally some dozens of people, and now you look at what God's doing. How did that happen? Well, of course, you know, we've paid attention to this and we've given our, and we've tried to do our best for this. But in the end, there is a miracle that only God can do. And that's why we give God praise and glory for all that he has done and is doing in our church, because it was the Lord's doing. If you've hit the brick wall today, I want you to start to look and think and have a different confession. Like Psalm 91 says, don't, you know, that might have been true for them and it might have, you know, 1,000 might have fallen here, 10,000 might, but it's not going to touch you. You're going to win through. You're going to break through on this. You're going to be a winner. You're going to be more than a conqueror through Christ who strengthens you. So number one is all about, if you need a breakthrough, it means you've hit a brick wall. Number two, if you've hit the brick wall, you're going to have to go to God. Where do you go to when you hit a brick wall? Where do you go to? Well, we're just going to have to learn how to go to God. How do you respond when you hit the brick wall? Well, I'll tell you how that I've responded and how many people in my ministry have responded when they hit a brick wall. The first thing they do is go to their friend. And they go to their friend and say, it's terrible. And it's like this. And normally in that conversation, it's their fault. Right? It's very, unless you're one of these super spiritual people, you don't really blame the devil to begin with. And if you're a real super spiritual person, you blame the devil, because the devil is responsible for everything. By the way, the devil is not responsible for every problem in the world. Do you know he is? He is not all powerful. You know, he roams around the earth, which means he can't be everywhere. He's not omnipotent, all powerful. He's not omniscient, all knowing. He's not omnipresent, all being everywhere. He's just a high heavenly being who fell from grace in heaven and is now, yes, he with the demons of hell is a prince and power in this air, but he has no authority whatsoever, because Jesus stood on the top of his neck and he declared himself to be more than a conqueror. So don't elevate his grandeur. He is not grand. He's a failed foe who keeps getting out of the box and trying to hurt you. Yes, he is prowling around looking for somebody to kill, steal, and destroy. But in the end, you are more than a conqueror through Christ who strengthens you, because Jesus is Lord. So what do you do? You go to your friend and you say, oh, it's terrible. You know, and the more you talk about it, the more you tell somebody, and then you find somebody else, and then you find somebody else who's also hit a brick wall. So now you've got, having hit the brick wall, anonymous group. And then somebody else joins you. And then the only thing that you do, sitting drinking coffee in Costa, is talk about how terrible the world is. You know, and it isn't too long before you get to how terrible the church is. Not here, of course. And it could get to how terrible the pastor is. Not this one, of course. But you know what I'm talking about? You've only got to get an environment of negative, negative, negative. We talked a bit about that in Stop Press today. And the whole thing goes downhill. It goes downhill and your mind is preoccupied with, yeah, but, you know, you've always got somebody who starts a conversation with yes, but. I've learned to not trust yes, but people. You know, when somebody, you know, saying, oh, hallelujah, it was great this morning. Yes, but. I'm thinking like, oh, no, quick, go. You know, because it doesn't take you anywhere except for into the cul-de-sac of the brick wall. What you got to do with the trouble? Go to God. Oh, what peace we often forfeit, the hymn writer said. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. You're going to have to learn how to, Pastor Wes was talking about it last week, seeking God first. You know, it's not only seeking God first and all of your desires, but seek God first when you're in trouble. When you're in trouble, go to God first. You just heard something from the doctor and it troubles you, go to God. You just had a bill that you can't pay, go to God. Why did you go to God in those circumstances? Well, because he said, I'm the healer. Because he said, I am the provider. You don't know what to do. Why do you go to God first? Because he is your wisdom. You know, he doesn't give peace. We spoke about this a couple of weeks ago. He doesn't give peace to you. He is peace. So when you've got him, you are at peace. The peace of God be with you. Well, yeah, God is in me. So if God is in me, what he's going to do is, can I say it like this? He's going to sweat peace all over me, and I'm just going to be at peace. Go to God. Because when you go to God and magnify the Lord in the middle of this, we've said it many times, haven't we? If you magnify God, turn your eyes on Jesus and the things of earth, the troubles, the wall that you just ran into grows strangely dim in the light of his glory, grace. Because the reason that you, when you go to God, he reminds you, well, my children, when they were coming out of Israel, they hit Jericho. But you know, I made a way in the wilderness. I made a way for them. I mean, he not only made a way for them at Jericho, but for the last 40 years, he made a way their shoes didn't wear out. He made a way that every day manna, 6 days a week, manna came down on the ground. He made a way so that even the water, when they were drinking it, he could turn it and make, wow, that's the miracle working power of God. And God has not changed. You've got to go to God. Hit the brick wall, go to God. Go to God first time. Go to God every time. You know, this is not a plea to stop people complaining. I thank God for a church that is very positive, that speaks very positive. You know, and the heart of destiny is very positive. If you ever hear somebody that's very negative, you know that's not the heart of God nor the heart of destiny. We're a church with a heart full of faith, heart full of encouragement, heart full of hope. You'll never hear me speaking anything other than, yes, we can. I'm a can-do person because God is a can-do person. Hallelujah. You know, why should I think like, no, this is not going to happen. With God, all things are possible. And when you hit a brick wall, don't say, brick wall, fall on me. Go to God and say, Spirit of the living God, fall on me. Because when the Spirit of God comes on you, you become empowered with all of the dunamis of God. Go to God. Number three. You hit the brick wall, you go to God, and what does God want to do? Sort it for you. Well, yes, but he also wants you to take charge of some of those things. It's called faith. You've got to grow your faith. How does faith come? By hearing the word of God. Psalm 91 will produce some faith in you. If you read that psalm this week every day and go through that whole thing and you read it and you read it and you read it, I tell you, your life will be changed. The problem is that we don't read enough word to give ourselves enough faith. I'm being really honest now. You know, if we were with God sat here on his throne, and he says, okay, remember he knows all things. We'll start off on the front row here. How much word reading today, this week, how much word reading? We're all thinking like, oh, no, it's time to go to the toilet. I can't. Yeah, we would be embarrassed, I think, you know, until you meet an occasional person who would stand up and say, well, I read the Bible 17 hours every day. And you think like, yeah, but you've got a real issue with pride. You know, we've got to get this sorted. Let's listen. forget about, I've met some people who want to tell me about how long they are in prayer and how long they're in the Bible every day. And I'm thinking, like, why are you telling me that? If you are in prayer and you're in the Word of God, it will be seen in your life and you don't need to tell me. Amen? But we've got to get into the Word. Because Word produces faith. And when faith is in your heart, you can say to this mountain, to your brick wall, you're about to move. See, what you've got to do is you've got two thinking. It's either, well, I'm going to have to go around you, climb up and over you, or I'm going to say to you, time to budge, mountain. And the Bible says, be removed into the sea. Amen? Oh, by the way, when you got through and over or round or directly through, the children of Israel went directly through, didn't they? They didn't go round the Red Sea. They went straight through it. You know, and you can go through some of your problems. And when you've got through, you think it's all over. Well, now you've learned how to move mountains. God will give you another mountain to move. And another mountain to move. And another mountain to move. That's until we come and see the hill of the Lord. Hallelujah. Life is a life of continually needing to live in victory. Stir your faith. Why did David go out of that mountaintop tent with King Saul, and they tried to have the armor on and all the rest of it? He said, oh, forget that. I'm going to do what I know, because he knew about faith. He knew that God was with him. He knew that he'd done extraordinary things in the past, even as a young man. He knew that when he stepped out in faith, God would work it out. He knew that he was on a mission. And I want to tell you something. If you go to God and you stir up faith, faith is about knowing. Not just knowing intellectually, but knowing in your heart. I know in whom I have believed. And I'm persuaded that he's not only able to keep that until that day, but I'm persuaded that between now and then, he's going to cause me to walk in faith and in victory, and I'm going to be more than a conqueror through Christ who strengthens me. Faith is when you know. The Bible talks about faith and doubt. And when we're in between faith and doubt, we're double-minded. The Bible says a double-minded man should not expect that he should receive anything from the Lord. So we've got to decide, which side are you going to come down on? Faith or doubt? Faith or doubt? It's a challenge in our mind. I've been there. You've been there. Maybe you're there right now. And I'm saying, come down on the side of faith. Because by faith, you can move mountains. By faith, you can say to this problem, to this wall, be gone. By faith, it releases to you all of heaven's miracles. You look in the New Testament, you'll see people who got healed. Why are they? Your faith has made you whole. Your faith. You say, well, it's Jesus. Yeah, it is Jesus. But your faith releases Jesus into your life and into your circumstances. You're just going to have to get some faith going. And fourthly, not only do we hit the brick wall and then in our lives we've just got to go to God, and when we get there we've just got to grow our faith, but actually faith will always cause you to do something. I've met many people who in their lives talking to me, they'll say, when God has done this, then I'll do that. It's like giving tithes and offerings. When I've got enough money, I'll give. You know, it doesn't work that way. If you give out of what you've got, God will give you more back, and then you'll have plenty to be able to live on, be able to give more. Give, and it will be given to you. It doesn't say it will be given to you, and out of that give. It's the other way around. You've got to go and do something. Children of Israel, when they were walking out of Egypt on the way towards the promised land, and they hit the Red Sea, did it part before they stepped into the water, or did they have to go and do something? You had to go and do something. You know, all the way through the Bible, you will find that faith is having to take that step before it releases something. I used to describe it many years ago when I was a young preacher. We were pioneering a church by the seaside, and I loved this idea. It's taking the step off the end of the pier. And you think, like, no, there's nothing there. But Peter had to do that when he walked out the boat, didn't he? Can you imagine the faith moment for him to go and do? He'd have never walked on water if he'd have stayed in the security of the boat. We've all had to at times, and you're going to have to. We as a church are going to have to in the days that are coming up. We're going to have to go and do something. You know, we can hit a brick wall, but God says to you, if we go to him and we produce and grow faith in our hearts, then there's a time that we come and do something. You know, we did that 10 years ago. as a church, we went and stepped out beyond our comfort zone, stepped out beyond where we are. You just got to go and do something. What did David do? He left the tent of Saul and he came out of the mountain and he came down to the valley and he knelt down into the brook and picked up 5 shiny stones. And I just know what he was dreaming about when he was doing that. He's thinking about, I wonder if it's going to be this one or this one, which is going to sink itself right into the head. He had no doubt. He was absolutely confident. And all the children of Israel were on the mountain watching this young boy down there. There'll be times when you'll feel alone. There'll be times when you feel like you're just being a pioneer and walking out on your own. But you're going to have to do something. Do something about your marriage. Do something. Do something about your children. Do something about your health. Do something about your finances. Do something about that situation that you've been facing down your street or in your relatives. Do something. Say, well, you know, me and my wife are not getting on very well. Well, do something. You've hit a brick wall in your relationship. Yeah, I know. Go to God. Be the right person. Pray for your wife. Pray for your husband. Let faith arise and go and do something. To go and do something might feel for you strange. It might be to say, you know, I'm so sorry. Well, it's all her fault. Oh, forget who's blaming in the middle of this. Just go and say, I'm sorry, and do it. It might be to go and buy some flowers. It might be to go and put her higher on your agenda than some of the other stuff that caused her the problem in the first place, or vice versa. Go and do something. You might be in a financial situation where you're like, you can't win through. Well, go and do something. You know, go and sow something good financially for the glory of God. Go and do something. It might be that you're praying for your family to come and know Jesus. Well, go and do something. Not only just preach the gospel to them, but go and show them some love and some care. Visit with them. Bake them a cake. Mow their grass. Do something. You know, God is asking us to do something. And David, he picked up his sling and he swung it round, and that pebble got released out of that leather thong, and off it was down. And then soon Goliath was on his back. Hallelujah. You know, there's breakthrough just ahead for you. There's no circumstance that you're going through right now that God doesn't already know about. You've hit the wall. You feel like you've bloodied the end of your nose. You've banged into that thing again. Well, it's time that you became more than a conqueror over those things. Hallelujah. God, there's breakthrough just ahead for you, for your family. There's no circumstance, whether it's personal, family, at all. You have got a moment of breakthrough. Say, well, is that balanced in the Word of God? Yes. Just think about it. Are we the children of God? Is God our Father? Is Jesus our Savior? Did He die so that we will struggle and represent Him from a weak, overturned, wobbly person that everybody in the world looks at us and says, well, he talks a good talk about Jesus, but look at his life. Do you think that's God's plan? I don't think it is. I think God's plan is, come unto me, all you that are weary and heavy laden, I will give you rest. I believe God's plan is that we come to him with our burdens and we take them to the Lord and leave them there and walk away free. Say, yeah, but I've still got the memories of all those problems. I know you'll have the memories, but sometimes you've got to take every thought and make it captive and still walk free, because whom the Son sets free is free indeed. So the Bible says, you can walk free. You can walk. You don't have to walk. You know, sometimes we walk with like a ball and chain on our leg. If only that had never happened, then I could walk free. Well, God comes with some great big bolt choppers, chops that off, and you can walk out free. And he, walking and leaping and praising God, can walk into the liberty that Jesus Christ has got for you. Never say, I can't, when God says, I can. Never say, it's not possible, when God says, it's possible. There's breakthrough ahead, not because you're the smartest dude, but because God is the greatest God. Hallelujah. The most loving God. Let me show you some other verses in the Bible, just as I conclude, that teach this. Revelation chapter 3, verse 8 says, see, I've placed before you an open door that no man can shut. What does that speak of? Breakthrough. Somebody closes the door on you, kick it open. Somebody else closes the door on you, kick it open. Somebody else closes the door on you, kick it open. Many years ago now, 20 years ago, some preacher said to me, and today I'm closing every door on this man's ministry. And some very bold person in my congregation, probably here, shouted out to that preacher, behold, I'll open a door, says the Lord, that no man can shut. Well, God did it. And did it. And is going to do it. Don't ever take a circumstance, a man-made circumstance, to lock you and imprison you in a situation. Joseph, you remember, he got this great big prophecy on him. He ended up in a pit. But God kicked open the door again for him. And soon, after quite a journey, and there's always a journey in this, he became second in Egypt, only second to Pharaoh, and became mightily used of the Lord. God can still do that for you. Kick the door open, because God's opening the door for you. In John chapter 8 and verse 31, 32, it says, if you continue in my word, then truly you are the disciples of mine, and you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Hallelujah. And that's what you've got to do. Hold the word of God. You will never be captive to anything if you'll keep the word of God inside you. Past mistakes are not going to hold you captive. People are not going to be able to hold you captive. You might feel under the influence of some powers that be. Well, I want to tell you, the powers that be, it might be some tyrant somewhere. But thank God, there's not a tyrant in heaven. There's a loving Heavenly Father who gives you victory in the name of Jesus. In Psalm 3, verse 8, it says, from the Lord comes imprisonment. Doesn't say that, does it? It says, from the Lord comes deliverance. You might feel trapped right now, but God, from the Lord comes deliverance. He came to deliver you from your past, to deliver you from this. You know, don't get all spooky about deliverance. There's no great big deal on that. It's just you were trapped there, and God comes and says, loose him and let him go, and he's free to go. Hallelujah. That's the deliverance that God wants to give you. And I love the next verse. May your blessing be on your people. Hallelujah. When God delivers you, he pours out his blessing on you. And there's another verse in 1 Corinthians 15, 57. It says, thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Victory? There's victory in that. We used to sing a lot of songs years ago about victory. Don't sing so many about that. Victory in Jesus and all these sort of songs. Listen, you don't need to be bound. You don't need to be stuck. You don't need to be held back somewhere. There's victory in the name of Jesus. And we need to start to get some victory thinking in our minds and in our hearts. In Isaiah 61 and verse 1, it says, and Jesus repeated this right in the Gospels and said, this day this scripture is fulfilled in your eyes. But we're going to read it out of Isaiah 61. It says, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners. You might have been held captive by something. I've come today, the Spirit of the Lord is on this guy today. And I'm proclaiming to you freedom. This is the day of freedom for you. This is the day that you can break out of where you've been held back. It might have been a mental thing, an emotional thing, a financial thing, a relationship thing. It might have just been a thing of your own making. I don't care what it is. God is able to proclaim freedom over you. You can walk free. And this can be your day to walk free. There's breakthrough just ahead. Romans chapter 8, 37, the last verse that I'm going to use right now. Romans 8, 37, it says, knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. Hallelujah. That is breakthrough just ahead. So what do you do with a message like that? Okay, well, I recognize the brick wall. I now need to go to God. And I need to stir my faith. And you now need to commit to do something. Maybe husband and wife, you need to commit to do something together. It's not been so great for you two. You struggled. Do something. Do something in faith. Do something that takes you to God. And see your Jericho wall come down. Maybe it's financial. Do something in faith, having been to God and see your financial walk on that. Whatever it is, God is able to do it.